Thank you, Mr. Ghasi. Honorable Taragan sir, Professor Abraham, friends and colleagues. Am I audible? Proceed. Okay. This is not going to be an in-depth analysis of what has happened, because whatever you have read in the media, I also have read. I have nothing additional, no additional inputs to analyze things better and give you a better assessment of the situation. So I'll start. I have made a few points. I will try to stick to it. Ms. Neetu told me that I will be able to speak to around 30 to 40 minutes, 45 minutes. Then there will be a Q&A or interaction or whatever. So my first encounter, I don't know whether that's the right word to use, with Hong Kong was on my way to Shanghai, where I was posted from 1994. The government of India has a way that in the olden days, China manufactured hardly anything. Whatever was available was of very poor quality. So the government allowed people going on a posting to the Indian embassy. We had no consulates at that time. Could stay in Hong Kong for a couple of days on government expense, buy whatever little you want to buy, and in the process make some, you know, TADA sort of thing. They give you $100 per person per day, so you can buy a TV or a mixer grinder or whatever you require. So that was the system they put in place. Probably that's still continuing even though we have a direct flight to Beijing. That's another matter. So I found that I'm not going to be diplomatic here, because I feel that when you analyze something, you have to be very, very objective. You have to put away your personal opinion, leanings, but then you have to be very objective. So I found the people in Hong Kong very arrogant, to put it very bluntly, maybe bordering racism. They were not friendly at all, particularly to colored people or Indians in particular. They have their own reasons. Some of the early Indian settlers in Hong Kong had, they are a trading community. So some of the Hong Kong people, the Chinese people, had bad experiences. Who will blame whom or who is correct and all, we cannot go deep into it. But they, even if you go to them, because Indians have a habit of asking people, where is this shop or location of some roads and all, we don't go by a map which is freely available in Hong Kong. We always keep asking, like in a Mohanlal movie, Chodichu Chodichu Pogam. So we keep asking people. So Hong Kong people hated this. The moment you approached a Hong Kong man or a woman, they will just say, go away, that was the attitude. But I came back to, I had personal, you know, personally some very bad experiences of some shopkeepers abusing you for no reason. Only thing, they felt that an Indian will go to, say, 10 shops asking for the price of an article, then ultimately buy it from an Indian or Pakistani shop who will be selling it at a cheaper rate. So the Hong Kong Chinese had a very poor impression about Indians in general. And but I went back to Hong Kong in 2006. I was posted to Hong Kong, and then there was a change. Even prior to that, in 1997, Hong Kong was handed over to China. Till that time, the Hong Kong people thought that they were equivalent to Britishers vis-a-vis Indians or Chinese, mainland Chinese. So I found they started speaking a little bit of Mandarin, and they were used to listen to you. Otherwise, they were very curt. They just shooed you away, to use the right word. There is a small Indian community there, very vibrant culturally and economically. Initially, they were all traders who, you know, migrated from, some from Pakistan, some from African countries, and doing very well financially. They have a sort of monopoly in certain areas. There were diamond merchants doing very well, all Gujaratis, you know, owning banks and ports and all those things, they all had representation in Hong Kong. Then, as I said, Hong Kong was handed over back to China after a 150-year-old colonization or lease by the Britishers. Hong Kong was called Hong Kong Special Administrative Region of China. This is under China's famous policy of one country, two systems. Hong Kong was a part of China, but they had a totally different system politically, economically, and in all respects, they had more freedom than the mainlanders. They had elections. They had self-governance, unlike in China. They had multi-party system, etc. This was all based on something called a basic law, which can be loosely compared to a constitution. China and Hong Kong fought over many years to come to this, make this basic law. So they go by the basic law, and any given point of time, an average Hong Kong man or woman enjoys more freedom than a man or woman on the mainland. They have their own separate currency. They have their own script, the old Chinese. They have no. When China moved to the simplified Chinese characters, Hong Kong has stuck to the old characters, like Taiwanese. In this context, I would like to say something about their culture. That's called a Canton culture, Cantonese culture, Kuang Tung Hua. Even the language they speak is Kuang Tung Hua. It's different from Mandarin. If a man from Beijing comes to Hong Kong and speaks in Mandarin, people there never understood it, and vice versa. It was like Tamil and Hindi, but they had the common script. So that was if they write to each other, they may understand it. But when they spoke to each other, it was speaking like, you know, a Tamilian speaking to a Punjabi in their own mother tongues. Then, of course, mainlanders used to come. China opened Hong Kong to their people. So they came. Chinese mainlanders started making money, the neo-rich, you know. So Hong Kong has stuck to the British culture of speaking softly, not touching somebody, on a bus. And they have their own eating habits and all, whereas mainlanders were brash with their newly found richness. So when they came with loads of money, which the Hong Kongers welcomed, but they did not like their behavior. There used to be often quarrels inside shopping malls and business centers, because the mainland people had their own way of talking, doing things and all. But the Hong Kong people loved their money, the mainlanders' money, but not them personally. Then the mainland ladies used to come, there became a particular sort of tourism, like in birth tourism in USA. In Hong Kong also, mainland ladies used to come and give birth to children in better hospitals. Because they thought that if a child is born in Hong Kong, he will be entitled to Hong Kong citizenship. When I say Hong Kong citizenship, this is different from mainland citizenship, but they are all Chinese nationals, but citizenship was slightly different. And with a Hong Kong passport, in the olden times, you can go to over 135 countries without a visa, where for a mainlander, that was not there. Even to USA, UK and all, Hong Kong passport had a lot of weight. In the process, you know, they had money. The mainlanders' parents, who could not go to good colleges, universities, they started sending their children to Hong Kong universities. And they had lots of money, as I said earlier. And they grabbed a lot of seats in the universities. Secondly, you know, initially when China became rich, Hong Kong was the center of many big corporates. And you know, the Chinese people who had migrated to Australia, Canada, USA, UK and all, their children were ready for taking up jobs. So all these multinational recruited those children and posted them to Hong Kong. But in a matter of time, the Chinese youngsters are so enterprising, so hardworking, they took that place. The Hong Kong man or average young man or young woman lost out to the mainland youngsters in university admissions and in job opportunities. And Beijing also diluted this basic law. Like we criticize, I am not very aware, I think Mr. Ghazi spoke at Maharaja's college yesterday about Article 370. Even 370 was diluted much before it was abrogated. So the Chinese did the same thing in Hong Kong. They did so many things. I don't want to enumerate everything. But they also, you know, captured the main popular media in. They bought all the many of the media houses. They brought in their own people as editors. Their editorial policies and editorial lines changed. They even had people posted in immigration departments, and they allowed asymmetric immigration from Hong Kong in comparison to from mainland to Hong Kong. So it's not like neutralizing the Hong Kong population, but people wanted to come there in search of better opportunities, and the Hong Kong government, under instructions of the mainland government, allowed that to happen. And they also developed an intelligentsia in Hong Kong, mainland intelligentsia, because they are full of money and they don't have to account for any money they spend on the mainland. And they also have political parties started in Hong Kong. Prominent among them is DAB, that is Democratic Alliance for Betterment, and I can't recollect the entire name. And they had their own vote share. It's a pro-China, pro-communist party. It's not a communist party. The moment you say communist party, people, you know, try to keep away from that in China, because most of them, people in Hong Kong, had migrated to Hong Kong, their fathers, because of communist rule at that time. They just swam across, because from Shenzhen to Hong Kong, it's just a bridge. If you travel from Hong Kong to Shenzhen on the mainland, by train, it's only 1 hour, by fast train, of course. So I just happened to see a study where they say that the Democratic Party in Hong Kong, which everybody thought that they will come to power, they had around 42% at a given point of time. I can't recollect the dates, but now they have only 9.2% support among the people, whereas DAB also lost out, but they had 25% support among the people at a given point in time, but it has reduced to around 17%. So they have their own, like in the CPM cadre-based organization, these people are also able to retain most of their cadres, unlike the Democratic parties. Now, Mr. Ghazi asked me about the cause of the unrest or protest in Hong Kong. We all know about the extradition treaty. But before coming to that, Hong Kong has a history of a protest. In fact, it started in the 1960s. That time it was the Britishers who ruled Hong Kong. And it was the leftist organizations, trade unions, started the protest at that time. Some of them were quite big. But they were bread and butter issues, unlike democracy, because Britishers were ruling, and even the leftists knew that Britishers were better for them to operate. Even inside China, if you are a leftist, you are, you know, viewed with a different set of glasses. So, like, there is something called Star Ferry. It's a ferry from Hong Kong. Hong Kong is full of islands. From Hong Kong Island to Kowloon Island, which are both are very busy places. Hong Kong houses the financial district, the embassies, where even our embassy is located. Kowloon is mostly business people, business center and housing colonies. So they increased the charge by a few cents and there was a huge strike. And I think there was also an issue with teachers' salaries. Hong Kong teachers in the government draw more than probably a senior most civil servant. There are Malayalis still working in Hong Kong, but they don't anymore recruit Malayalis as English teachers. And $80,000 and all Hong Kong dollars per month. Even that is about 8 lakh rupees per month was an excellent salary for a teacher to get anywhere in the world. Then there were so many protests. They used to routinely commemorate the Tiananmen Square incident in China. They will assemble at a place called Victoria Park, huge assembly. They sing songs and all. But it was all peaceful. Even the 60s protests were very peaceful. And if I can recollect, I think 2003 there was a big protest. I think nearly 500,000, 5 lakh people assembled for that. Then they introduced a similar bill in the parliament. It's called a subversion, anti-subversion law. I can't recollect the exact name of the bill. Hong Kong people felt that this is to, arrest people engaging in political activities in Hong Kong under the mainland instructions. Then they had to again withdraw this agreement. Then another major protest was in 2014, very famous one. It also went on for weeks together. I think it went on for nearly 70 days. And the difference between the current the modalities of the current set of protest and in the past is that in the past they used to occupy a place. They call sit-ins, dharna sort of thing. But there are beautiful videos. The whole Hong Kong is sitting on a street. Suddenly an ambulance comes, like, when Moses, when the river split, or in Krishna's case also, like these people as a wave moving and allowing the... So that was a disciplined sort of protest in those days. Why a lot of violence at the moment? I think we will come to that later. So this went on for nearly 70 days and businesses lost. Hong Kong is a trading center basically. It's a financial center and people occupying main centers means you lose business. People lose jobs. Then DAB, I told you, the pro-Beijing party. Then some businessmen, they have trade unions. And the policemen colluded and beat them up. They just give good thrashing to the young students and middle-aged people, and they had to run away. And the protest had a very sad end at that time. It just dissipated that way. That's why I wrote an article about Hong Kong protest some 2 months back in Matrubhumi. There I said that the problem with Hong Kong protest is that you have to choose a right time to start a protest. In the same way, you need a right time to end it also. You should know, otherwise any history of a protest will say that it will have a natural death, slow death in the long run. So why violence this time? There are several versions to it, but I read some... Hello? I read some, pieces by some independent Western people. They say that they observed some mainlanders, because coming to Hong Kong is not an issue. So probably the security set up on the mainland, sent some people disguised as protesters in the black dress. And they speak pure Mandarin with Beijing accent, which is very distinct, very sweet to hear. And they probably started the chaos. They merged with the people. And Hong Kong people could easily identify these people because of their body language, their language. And they started beating up. They tried to beat back these people, and that was the beginning of the violence in Hong Kong, in the current wave of Hong Kong protest. How far this is true, I cannot vouch for it. I have read in some places. And you know, when the protests were going very strong, the chief executive agreed to, I think with Beijing's consent only, without that she cannot do it, agreed to withdraw the this extradition treaty. But she did not scrap it. Then the protesters said that, you know, you have to scrap it and give an assurance that it will not be brought back at a later stage. They wondered, you know, the government said this is rioting. They said that term should be removed. Then all charges against the protesters should be dropped, and they needed universal suffrage. That is one man vote system in Hong Kong, which the mainland had promised them long time back. So I'll slightly go back to the system of the government. Government, they have a legislative council equivalent to our parliament. So I will stick to the word parliament for ease of understanding. Around 70, I think it's 7, they have 70 members. 70 out of 70, 35 are elected by the people, in some cases through the district councils. Then remaining 70 people come from different constituencies. That's a different profession. They will have a representative, an MP from tourism industry. They have an MP from trading. They have an MP from from among teachers. So the mainland ensures that these people are their people. The 35 people at least support the government, because they are chosen in a way that they are supporters of the government. When people choose somebody, he could be either pro-government or anti-government. When I say government, I mean the mainland government. So they ensure that. But mainland government, that's the central government, had promised them one man vote system long time back. I was in Guangzhou, that's close to Hong Kong. We had a new consulate. Then we used to observe what was happening there. And the mainland promised them that, okay, we will introduce universal suffrage from 2008-2012. Now they say that we will have it from 2017. The issue is that mainland will not be happy to introduce it so fast. They may do it at a later stage. They want to prepare their country, that the mainland country, mentally to see that what's happening in Hong Kong. Because if they give universal suffrage in Hong Kong, and if the mainland man has only a single option of electing a Communist Party cadre as his representative, that will have a bad effect on the mainland system. That is something like a president or a prime minister in Hong Kong. They call it chief executive. Chief executive will be the process for electing the chief executive will be settled first before we go to the aspect of electing people through one man one vote system. Now what they do is chief executive under the basic law is elected indirectly, in the sense that there is an electoral college of I think 1200 people, and they select a candidate, one candidate, or if there are two people, they vote, put them to vote, and this person is approved by the mainland. So this electoral college is selected by, again, mainland government approved. So they select an electoral college, the mainland government, and they select one chief executive candidate who is approved by the mainland. So China ensures that their man or woman, their person is, they becomes the chief executive. So their writ runs in Hong Kong. This is a very, very much unacceptable to Hong Kong people. So they are fighting for universal suffrage, and now again they have raised the issue. So as in many countries, when such massive protests happen, the main focus shifts to other things like democracy, Like people ask somebody to ask the municipal authorities to behave, even in Kashmir, when a death happens due to an accident also, when the janaza is taken to the funeral procession comes, it turns into an anti-India, anti-central government movement. There are occasions this happens. So it happened in Hong Kong also. So universal suffrage is one thing very sensitive for the Chinese to handle. So I don't think, in my view, the Chinese government will ever allow universal suffrage to be given to the Hong Kong people, that too at the end of a wave of protest. That means the people have demanded for it, they have got it, which the Chinese government or the Communist Party will never accept. Now, what happened to Hong Kong people because of the protest is economy. As I said, it's based on trading, financial, then trading means retail trading, then shipment. Many of the Indian companies, because in China they have a rule, if you buy things in China, you go to for business purposes, you buy things, you have a container or two container lots of things, you cannot ship it in your own name. You, as a consigner, as a person who sends it, there has to be a Chinese company who will be sending it. So there are people from Kerala also having some sort of agencies, or they set up a company. Opening a company in China is very easy, closing it is much more difficult. There are other companies which are representational companies, so they can generate business, they cannot do business. So these companies have offices in Hong Kong. So most of the companies in Hong Kong, I'm talking about the Indian company, they have offices on the mainland and they ship the things. But all these have come to a stand. Though the protests are mainly during weekends, mostly Sundays, Friday evening, Saturday, even on Sundays, but the business has affected. An unfortunate thing, I spoke to somebody who whose son is in Hong Kong, is a journalist. Many of them have been have their contracts suspended for 2 months at the moment. They have given the salary for 2 months in advance. They said your contract stands suspended. If you want to go home, you can go home and come back after 2 months. But many of the people feel that that's the end of their career. This is an unfortunate thing. Sales of things, people are buying only very, essential items, like a magazine or a lifestyle magazine, for example, had zero sale during the past 2 months. Nobody is buying these things. So this is a major thing. People are losing money, people are losing jobs, people are losing businesses. People are planning, the businessmen are planning to move to other countries, their offices. Financial institutions are not bringing in money to Hong Kong. Everybody is suspicious of what will happen tomorrow. Because China is, even if the protest ends in after a few weeks or few days, China is going to have a stricter control in Hong Kong for their own sake. For the sake of the mainland, the entire mainland cities. And this time they have adopted to throwing petrol bombs, Molotov cocktail. I don't know how they made it. Otherwise, normal Hong Kong Chinese youngster, if you look at him, is apolitical. He was very apolitical. But now he feels that the youngster who is in the university will lose his career. He may not progress beyond a limit when he, because this one country, two systems system will be over in another 27, 28 years. That time the youngster, the teenager who are at the forefront of present the protest, they will be in their prime. So they will not go beyond there will be a glass ceiling, because mainlanders will be there at that time to take up. And in mainland, it is not merit that matters. Merit, of course, matters, but it is the quanxi. They have this word quanxi on the mainland. Quanxi means relationship. It is not simple relationship. if I know Professor Dawson, he is a professor in Maharaja's University College, and if there is a post of lecturer coming up there, if he knows me, I get the job. This is happening in mainland. So if you have contacts or relationship, things happen on the mainland. Rules are set aside on the mainland, even though it's ruled by a communist country. So they don't want this thing to happen on the mainland. So the middle-aged people were very enthusiastic initially as the protest started, but now they are getting fed up because it's going into 3 months, it may go into 4 months, we don't know. But the youngsters are still have enthusiasm because they are worried about the future. They are worried about their younger brothers who may not get their seats in the universities. They may lose out on job in the job market also. This is the main thing. So this time also, I said mainlanders had sent, the Chinese government had sent some gundas, to put it very bluntly, to create chaos in the protest. Like last time, they used something called triad. Triad means it's an underworld that's very active in Hong Kong. They have tentacles all across Asia, maybe even USA, UK and all, in the Chinatowns. So this time also they used it. But the young brigade, that is the youngsters who are protesting, are very vigilant in this matter. So another thing I noticed this time in the protest was, last time I said they were sitting at a place and protesting. So it was easy to remove them, comparatively easy. Whereas this time they are very mobile. They don't sit in a place for a long time. And they move from place to place. They communicate through their social media devices, and they act very fast. They say, okay, let's go to point X now. Then so many people will be there, because people who are in that area, they will already move there, start their protest. But unfortunately, what I found that they destroyed a lot of property. They destroyed airport property, banks, anything connected with the mainland, and the metro system. Hong Kong metro system is one of the best in the world. Very, very, very pragmatically designed. The metro will go, even our admiralty where this thing is happening, our embassy can be accessed by the metro station in 2 minutes time. And underneath also, they have huge underpasses from one station to the main centers, and they have very clear markings towards city center tour. So it's such a beautiful system, and the protesters attacked it, and people are not happy about it. That's why last week they shut down the metro, the entire metro system in China, in Hong Kong. They also shut down several other things, even eateries, all restaurants were closed. People went hungry, because there are several people who don't cook at home. They get food. Nobody thought that they will shut down the, even Pizza Hut was, I had a friend's son, I told you, he has a small cat. So luckily he had food for cat, but no food for him, because he was expecting to go out and eat. Then somebody had to come and pick him up in his car and take him to his house and feed him for 2 days. An interesting aspect of the present wave of protest is that it is not organized by any body means any organization. The only sign of an organization you could see in Hong Kong was there were some first aid or emergency medical teams operating in some areas. Otherwise, absolutely no sign of any organization. And these youngsters use social media forum called LIHKG. HKG stands for Hong Kong, and they use Telegram for that, which is relatively trouble free. So they use it. That's why they are able to communicate fast and act fast. So they say, okay, let 2,000 people assembled in that area, all those people in that area will go there within 10 minutes. Because Hong Kong is such a tiny place, you could move from one place to other in no time. Leaders, there are no organizations and there are no leaders also. When this present wave of protest started, the 2014 protest leader, Joshua Wong, was in jail. He was still, in the jail, completing his punishment term in the jail. He came out only, I think, two or three weeks before. So even he is not the sole leader. They discuss all these things, what to do next. They discuss on the social, LIHKG and Telegram. And when they find that most of the people or a majority of the people want this particular action to be taken, they go for that. This is a very strange sort of thing. This probably is good, probably is bad. In my view, a leader is required. Without a leader, chaos can happen. Probably the chaos what we witnessing today is intentional, not because they don't have any leader, but definitely this may have an impact because this Joshua Wong and others went to USA to give some statements to their congressional committee or Senate committees and all. I will come to that in a moment. And they have hurting the mainland. Chinese are very patriotic. More than patriotic, they are very nationalistic. Because the Communist Party and the government has used the public, used nationalism as an instrument to whip up frenzy in the country. If they have problem with Japan on something, whether they are correct or not, that's a different question. They can assemble so many people in front of the Japanese embassies or Japanese restaurant, create situation so that the Japanese government comes under pressure. This is a tactics the Chinese have been doing. So this time they burned the Chinese national flag, which is, in my personal view, is not a way to show your protest against a country or a government. Then they also booed when the national anthem was sung. The national team, one of the football teams came, they booed them when the Chinese national anthem was sung there. So this also shows that there is no organization which is controlling them. Because if it's an organization, they will be very, very careful. One of the protesters threw the Chinese national flag into the sea, which is very symbolic. They're throwing you out into the sea. So these things have antagonized the mainland government. And I think when Mr. Ghazi spoke to me about this topic, I said, let's keep simply as Hong Kong crisis so I can get away by saying all these things. Then he was very particular that I should speak about the geopolitical implications of this particular wave of protest. I don't know what geopolitical impact or implications it may have, but definitely USA has entered the scene. This is what I've seen. There were pictures of a US consul working in the US Consulate General in Hong Kong, speaking to some protest leaders in some places. Obviously, maybe some guidance is coming. And for any protest, I repeat this, any protest happening anywhere in the world, and if it continues for more than a week, that is into several weeks, definitely they need funding. Even though they don't need big placards or anything, without money, no protest can be organized. You cannot buy a bottle of water in Hong Kong, which is so expensive. People have to, people like us in the embassy, we don't buy mineral water. We, put an RO and try to, they say portable, tap water is portable, but it's so expensive. A bottle of water may cost you anywhere around $16-$17 and all. So for a protest of this size to succeed or to continue for this long, definitely needs funding, and it should have come from some obvious sources. And during the protest, sometimes you could see a American flag, sometimes a British flag, sometimes an old flag of Hong Kong when UK was ruling. I don't know what they meant by that. Do they want to be colonized by Britain? I don't know. And they have now introduced some new national anthem. It's not a national anthem. The protesters have some glory to Hong Kong or something, they have it. So definitely, if Americans were not supporting, they would not have gone to the, some leaders of the protest movement would not have gone to USA and given statements in the congressional committees there. So definitely UK, USA is definitely there. And some people were calling out to Donald Trump, please help us. They don't realize that Donald Trump is a transactional man. If it suits him, he will definitely support Hong Kong. Tomorrow, if China does gives him a concession on some trade issue, he will support China. So that is that's why that shows that no organization is controlling them. But and even if USA supports them, I don't know how long they will be able to support. They may just, you know, pull the strings from behind and create nuisance. Not because they love Hong Kong, because under, you know, all the American presidents in the past always wanted to cherish and nourish democracy across the world. For propagating democracy, they, whatever they did in the Middle East and all, they say it's because we want to nourish democracy. But Donald Trump doesn't believe in that. He has very openly told that he doesn't believe in that. So it's not out of love for democracy that USA, whatever they are supporting. I am not privy to any information about this. Even if they are supporting, it's not because of any love for democracy. It suits Donald Trump or the American administration at the time to support these people. And it had a good impact on the China-Tibet. Tibet, when I say Tibet, means Dalai Lama setup. I think they are planning to invite Dalai Lama for next round of talks, which they had suspended long time ago, because now America has started speaking about Xinjiang also. They were quite, you know, they spoke about Kashmir, the lockdown in Kashmir, but they kept quiet on Xinjiang. They didn't want to antagonize Chinese government. So now they have started talking about Xinjiang. And, you know, yesterday, Donald Trump said to Turkey that I will wipe out Turkish economy if you don't handle the their fight against Kurdish rebels in Syria more humanely. So we know what Donald Trump means by it. Definitely outside help may be there. I cannot vouch on this aspect. So now I will come to the last point, and about businesses moving, the implications. I don't think any business will move to India. The type of businesses that happen in Hong Kong will ever move to India. India is not ready for that sort of thing. They may at best move to Singapore, which is already happening for the past several years because of the Hong Kong climate. It's all polluted. Now, earlier they had, you know, manufacturing industry which migrated to mainland China, neighboring Guangdong province and all. So when Guangdong became, you know, rich, manufacturing has moved to western borders. So pollution was created in Hong Kong by the Hong Kong industry, which died a long time ago. Now they said that it is because of manufacturing on mainland in Guangdong, neighboring Guangdong. Now hardly any not much manufacturing happens in Guangdong. So many people, especially people who can afford and who had an option, move to Singapore much before. So that may have and some of the big corporate headquarters, regional headquarters and all may move to Hong Kong. I know for certain that Chinese had an idea to replace Hong Kong as the biggest financial center in the region long time ago. That was from the 19, There were some publications, nothing secret about it. They had a step-by-step, year-by-year analysis at which year, what did Shanghai do to replace Hong Kong. So definitely some people say that Xi Jinping has mentioned to somebody that I will teach the Hong Kong people a lesson, which obviously he would have said. So I don't know what he means by it. But if you look at it, Xi Jinping is more, has shown a lot of restraint in handling the Hong Kong protest. Had it been, you know, somebody like Chiang Zemin, I'm not, definitely he would have done something. Because when it comes to their core interests, the Hong Kong was not a part of their proclaimed set of core interests. Because there was no major issues at that time. But if I think if you recall the 13th National People's Congress, which happened in March 2018, I am not very sure about the date. Xi Jinping has very clear, it's on the net. Xi Jinping has very clearly said that not an inch of the motherland will be allowed to be separated from the country. He has very, very clearly, categorically said. And also, even before that, 2013, the Communist Party Congress, he had made very categorical statement about the protecting their territorial integrity. It might not apply to India. It might apply to probably what's happening in South China Sea dispute, or maybe even East China Sea problem with Japan. But definitely, Chinese will bring democracy. I will come to that later. So China did a lot of saber rattling. They had, we all read it in the newspapers, they had people's armed police, something like our central police forces, had big drills happening in Shenzhen. From there, they can just cross the bridge and come to Hong Kong. They had assembled a lot of armored personnel carriers and all, reminiscent of the Tiananmen Square time. So they tried to scare, threaten the Hong Kong demonstrators, but they never bothered about all these things, because probably the Hong Kong demonstrators feel that China will not use force against them. Force, when I say force, means not the police, I mean the army. Like Nehru, Pandit Nehru never thought that even if we have border issues, China will never use armed, engage in an armed aggression against India. Because he had probably some assurances from some quarters. He used to allow them more time to wear them down and use domestic forces, like their pro-China parties. Then there are trade unions supporting the mainland, because that is their bread and butter issue. There are retail traders unions who are affected the most. Probably these people will be further encouraged to face these people, but who can face when a crowd is swelling up to 2 million people? 2 million, Hong Kong population is probably 7.6 or some million. So 2 million people assembling for a protest means it's even big for India. That is, every one person out of three attended a protest. So then nobody can, do this. But definitely they will be planning something. I thought that they may do something. They were waiting for the October 1 parade, and when the whole world's attention will be on China. So probably, I think month of October may be crucial in this. And for China, Hong Kong is an issue affecting the whole of China. It's not an issue affecting Hong Kong. Because there are, firstly, Taiwan. Taiwan will be closely watching it. And if mainland China uses excessive force in Hong Kong, that will affect the pro-Chinese or nationalist parties in Taiwan. Then Xinjiang is there, Tibet is there. So all things are in a way related to each other. So probably that's one thing which is preventing the mainland government from using the army to crush the protest. But in my personal view, I may be exaggerating it a little bit. When it comes to protecting China's national interest, they will not hesitate for a moment to use the army to quell the protest. So I think it's better that the Hong Kong protesters have some good advices other than the so-called American consul who has been, seen on the newspapers and TV as advising them. So for China, my last word again is, it is a matter that affects the whole country. So they will definitely be very strict with it. When some action will happen, because Carrie Lam has refused to call these people for dialogue. That is very unfortunate. Carrie Lam is the chief executive, the so-called president or prime minister of Hong Kong. So maybe she will be asked to call these people, calm them down. But they may even scrap the extradition bill totally. But what they are asking now is universal suffrage. That will not come at anybody's demand. That will come only when China wants to give them that. Thank you.